Our gospel for today comes from John chapter 15, verses 9 through 17, and it's found on page 84 in your New Testament if you'd like to follow along. Hear the good news for this day. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you, so that my joy may be in you, that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends. You do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I heard from my Father. If you did not, here's the important part. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. This is our good news for this day. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
When I read today's reading, our gospel for today from John, I walked away with one feeling: overwhelmed. God is perfect, right? God is massive beyond all reckoning, right? Powerful doesn't even scratch the surface of the raw physical and spiritual capabilities of the Creator of everything, right? God is big and massive and amazing, incredible, and we are less. And yet, we can abide in the love of Jesus. We can truly be filled with all the love that Jesus has in him if we keep Jesus' commandments. And we're not only promised that level of love, but also joy. A joy that will be complete, a joy to akin to what Jesus feels himself. And again, Jesus is God. So all-powerful, almighty, and you get to feel that love that God has within him. Doesn't that seem like more love and joy than we can hold in our bodies? You can have all of that love that God has in our feeble human form. Don't you feel like that much love would just kind of make you explode? There's a comedian, Mitch Hedberg, that talks about how this bottle is a lie. How you can't have two in one. It's why we invented the number two. We had all these ones, and we're like, wait a minute, there are too many of them. And someone's like, what about the number two? And we're like, yeah. Two can't fit in one. That much love, that much joy. How can we fit that inside of ourselves? When I hear the promises of Jesus, this is what comes to mind. It seems like too much. And then I'm overwhelmed by the promises of God. I don't know that I would have always felt this promise of all this love and all this joy as overwhelming, but I certainly do now because I had kids. They are 3 and 5 now. And even though they are 3 and 5, every night after they go asleep, I quietly sneak into their rooms and put my hand on their chest. Okay, they're breathing. And then I'll back away. I do this every single night. I can't, if I forget to do it, I can't sleep. I need to go, okay, yeah, they're breathing. And then for nearly every time, then I'll step back and I'll look at them. And they're finally quiet. They're no longer breaking anything. They're no longer shouting at each other. They're no longer wrestling. And I just sit there for a second and watch them. And I'm filled with a love that I have no other way to describe it than it hurts. It's such a moment of love that I can't, there's no other way to describe it. It hurts. And knowing that I'm an imperfect person, and knowing that it's late at night, and knowing all of my limitations, I know that this love that I am feeling is not even close to the level of what Jesus is describing here, of this all-powerful, almighty, all-knowing. And yet we're promised that. A love beyond anything that we've ever felt or known before. We're promised that. And it's supposed to be a good thing. But it seems like it could be a fearful thing. And before you start thinking, okay, this is just Pastor Adrian being weird, and that's totally fine for you to believe, before you start shouting that out, I want you to know that this particular fear is not actually a new thing. It's a very old fear about wondering what we can do in the face of all that God can bring to us. We heard about this in our first reading, about the danger inherent to God. There was this ancient idea within Jewish understanding that you could not see the face of God and live. That held within the face of God was such power and holiness and awesomeness that the human brain simply couldn't handle it, would melt. We saw the face of God. Fairly early on in the Old Testament, they started using this phrase, and it's in the book of Genesis, and it feels like a throwaway line. They refer to this being that's an angel of the Lord, and we think, okay, they're visited by an angel. But it's not just an angel. It's not a representative of God. It's a representation of God, but one that would not explode people. Because very early on, they knew that they couldn't stand in the presence of God because God was too loving and great and powerful. So they came up with this phrase, the angel of the Lord. And our first reading talks about that fear. Moses and God were having a back and forth of Moses saying what he wanted, and then suddenly things get serious, and God says, "But," he said, "you cannot see my face, for no one shall see me and live." And the Lord continued, "See, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock, and while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen." God has to place Moses in a particular place and hide him until the right moment, and Moses can only look for a fraction of a second in order to not be destroyed by just seeing God. Now let me ask you a question. I know what I think my answer is, what the right answer is, but it's most definitely up for debate. What is more powerful and potentially more dangerous? Seeing the face of God for an instant, or feeling the full force of the love of God? To me, feeling perfected love has far more power than a fleeting vision of something out of the corner of your eye. Because we see things out of the corner of our eyes all the time. Did I just see what I thought I saw? Nah, it's just one of those things. But to feel love, when you felt that sensation, that overwhelming power, it stays with you. And the more I think about it, the more I think about these fears, these powerful options, so to speak, they're really about the same thing. A very human thing. Something that we all fall victim to in one way or another. I remember one particular Sunday I was talking about the ruts of our life. How the wheels of our lives wear down and wear down until we're locked into only doing everything that same way. same breakfast cereal, same path, same first thing, same conversation, same safety. Living in a rut, we call it. And I still remember someone in this congregation shouted, "But I love my ruts." And that is the truth. We love our ruts, even if we hate them. We do the same thing over and over because it's better than the alternative, the unknown. What might come to replace our beloved ruts? What happens if we get off track? And it's hard to imagine something more rut-breaking, more life-changing than the appearance of God, than seeing God, than feeling the love of God. And so we run from it. We hide from it. We label it as something that's dangerous. Avoid it at all costs. And then it transforms our prayers. We pray, "God, let your presence come in our midst. But don't do anything scary. And don't change anything that I actually like. And don't introduce me to a new person unless they don't say much. And only if they agree with me politically. On second thought, God, just please throw things to me from far away. And don't come near. In Jesus' name we pray." This is our human condition. Our ruts, our fears, our walls, our limitations setting the course of our everyday lives. And our God, our friend, as Jesus calls himself in our gospel, our divine friend, just couldn't live with us slowly dying in our ruts anymore. We have this idea in our heads that we find God, that we choose God. But over the course of the Old and New Testament, the entire way through this big, long story of God's love for us, people aren't choosing God. God, time and time again, is chasing after them. We hide from God. We run from God. We flee from God, which is why there is this truly earth-shattering passage in our gospel for today that we normally just skim right past. Jesus says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you." God, our friend, doesn't want us to live in darkness anymore. God, our friend, doesn't want us digging deeper and deeper into our ruts so that we can't even get a glimpse of God from down in our little trenches and holes. God, our friend, doesn't want us to experience a piece of love or a kind of love or a little bit of love. God, our friend, doesn't want that life for us. God wants us to be filled with the love and joy that is inherent to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, God our friend. Do not let your lives be ruled by fear. Do not let your ruts decide your path. Do not push away the great gifts of God that are waiting for us, a love so great, a joy so great that you feel like you might explode. But the good news is that we have a God, a friend, that will always show up to put the pieces back together.